In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
Many years ago, when I was about sophomore in college, my father decided to take our whole family on a trip during the Christmas break to Southern California. Well, my mother had a sister that lived in Southern California in San Bernardino, and so while we were down there, my parents took us to a number of different attractions in Southern California. And we went to one place called SeaWorld, and I was watching the trainers, and they had different, they had seals and dolphins and that would, what would you say, perform tricks. So I was watching these trainers with these sea creatures, and every time they would successfully do the performance, they would throw them a fish and give them a fish. But I noticed something else. I noticed that when the dolphins would come up, the trainer would go and they would pat them right behind the eyes. They'd pat them like this when they'd done things right. I thought, this is very interesting. Even animals are seeking approval from somebody or something. Have any of you ever had a dog as a pet, and you could tell this dog was seeking your approval, and would do a lot of things to try to get your approval? And so even animals seek approval, and human beings seek approval. Some people are seeking approval from somebody in their family, or they're seeking approval from somebody where they work, or somebody in a social situation. But as a Christian, the highest goal of my life needs to be to seek the approval of God. And so, how can you be assured? How can you know that what you're doing, the kind of life you're living, is meeting the approval of God? And it has been our sad experience in doing evangelism that we have met people. They wanted to join our church. They wanted to be Seventh-day Adventists. But when we showed to them God's requirements, they were willing to follow all of them. I could name you many different kinds of examples. I've mentioned some of these before. We had a lady that was, she and her husband knew about Adventism. She was not an Adventist, but she was studying Adventism. And she was studying with our Bible worker. She was coming to church. She was coming to prayer meeting. And one night after prayer meeting, just came right here. She came right up here. And she said to me, she was crying. She had tears rolling down her cheeks. She says, "I cannot become a Seventh-day Adventist." Well, why is that? Why can you not become a Seventh-day Adventist? Well, the Bible worker that afternoon, I think it was that afternoon, had studied with them what the Bible teaches about health reform. Does the Bible have instruction about health reform? Yes, it does. Very specific instruction. And our Bible worker showed this lady that to follow the Bible, we could not use tobacco. We couldn't use we couldn't use alcohol. We couldn't use unclean foods, as named in Leviticus 11, and we could not use coffee and tea and When she found this out, she came up to here and she told me with tears running down her cheeks, and that, by the way, was the last time I think she was ever in this church. He says, I cannot become a Seventh-day Adventist. Why? Because, she said, he showed me that I cannot be a Seventh-day Adventist and drink coffee. And my husband and I, we are connoisseurs of coffee. We have all kinds of coffee, we're connoisseurs of coffee. We can't give that up. So he did not become a Seventh-day Adventist because of coffee. I can tell you many other stories like that of people that wanted to follow God. They wanted to do, but there was something that God required that, well, they weren't willing to do it. I remember the man in Keene, Texas, his wife was a Seventh-day Adventist. He was not. I knew this man because he worked at a local Adventist-owned auto parts store. And when I would go there to buy parts for my car, he'd be at the counter. So he was a counter person. And so I knew this man. And I was visiting their home one Sabbath afternoon. And so we were on a first name, but we knew each other. And he said to me that he said he'd like to become a Seventh-day Adventist, but he says, I can't become a Seventh-day Adventist. So why is that? Because I cannot give up tobacco. And I've thought of these situations many, many times. What are you going to think about in the day of judgment? You're going to say to the Lord, well, I enjoyed the coffee. I enjoyed the tobacco. I've given up eternal life. I'll enjoy that for a little few. Is that the way you're going to think? You're going to realize that you made the most awful, short-sighted decision. So I want to study with you for a few minutes tonight about meeting God's approval. And there's a lot of texts in the New Testament. We'll look at many texts in the New Testament about this. Before we open God's holy book, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Our Father in heaven, we pray that as we study your word, through the power of your Holy Spirit, that you will make it clear to every one of our minds what it is that we are to do so that we can be approved of you, so that our life can be approved by our Creator. And Lord, if there's something in our heart, in our life, that is not approved of you, we pray that as we study this subject, that your Holy Spirit will point it out to us. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Help us to change those things that you do point out to us that are flaws in our religious experience. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Open your Bible to Romans 14. Romans 14. We'll start reading in verse 10. Romans 14, 10. Why do you judge your brother? Or why do you show contempt for your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then, each of us shall give account of himself to God. We're all going to give an account of ourselves to God. Paul says something very similar to this in 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians 5. He says in verse 10, we read this verse often, it says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the deeds done in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. But notice what he says in verse 9. Because we're going to have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account. Notice what he says. Therefore, we make it our aim, whether present or absent, to be well-pleasing to Him. Like I said, that is the goal of every Christian. The goal of my life is to live in such a way that my life will be well-pleasing to my Creator. Paul talks about this subject in many different ways, many different texts. Let's look at several others. In the book of Philippians, chapter 1, verse 27, he says, "Let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel." Talks about the same objective in Ephesians 4:1. He says, "I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to have a walk worthy of the calling with which you were called." What's the calling with which we were called? He talks about that to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:9. He said, "Who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to His own purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ Jesus before time began." And so, in my daily life, I have a goal to live in such a way that I will meet the approval of God and to make progress so that I will be ready for the return of my Lord. Let's look at a couple of texts that specifically talk about that. Philippians 3. Verse 14, he says, "I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." Colossians 1, 26 to 28, he talks about the same thing. He says, "The mystery which has been hidden from ages and from generations, but now has been revealed to His saints. To them God willed to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Him we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus." His goal, he says, was to present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Look what he says to the Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 13. "Finally, brethren," this is 2 Corinthians 13:11. "Finally, brethren, farewell, be perfect." Most modern translations say "become complete." That's all right. I like the word "perfect" better because I think it gets the idea across better. You're not complete unless you are perfect. "Be of good comfort. Be of one mind. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you." So, how shall I live then so that I will have God's approval in the judgment? We're living in a time when the entire world more and more rapidly is becoming ranged into two classes of people. The obedient and the disobedient. Now, some people get discouraged when they look at this and they say, I've had people say to me, well, nobody's perfect. The devil has been holding this up before God's children for thousands of years, saying that you can't be perfect and you can't keep the law and you can't do what God says to do. This is what the great controversy was over in heaven. This is what the great controversy was over when Christ was here. And I want to read to you what I wrote this actually, I believe, to a minister. And she wrote about what Jesus did so that you and I could be in heaven. Here's what she wrote. It's in Volume 2 of the Testimonies. It says, He, that is Jesus, laid aside His glory, His dominion, His riches, and sought after those who were perishing in sin. He humbled Himself to our necessities, that He might exalt us to heaven. Sacrifice, self-denial, and disinterested benevolence characterized His life. That's something that's profitable to think over. Three things she mentions. She says, sacrifice, self-denial, and disinterested benevolence characterize His life. He is our pattern. Have you, Brother A, imitated the pattern? I answer, no. Now notice what she says next. He is a perfect and holy example given for us to imitate. We cannot equal the pattern. But we shall not be approved of God if we do not copy it. And according to the ability which God has given, resemble it. We cannot equal the pattern. But if we're going to be approved of God, what does it say we must do? We must copy it. As far as we can, we are to resemble it. The time will never come when you and I can equal the pattern. Let me explain it this way. If you have a mirror that is made to perfection and you hold that mirror to the sun, the mirror will reflect the sun to another object. But the mirror is not the sun. But the mirror can reflect sunlight to others. You and I can never equal the pattern. But if we're to be approved of God, we are to copy it and as far as we can resemble it. I'm sure I will never know in this world how this happened, whether it was something that he did himself or whether it was placed in his hands after his death. But I well remember, my wife and I were living in Chehalis, Washington when this happened in 1978. And a man was elected to be the new pope. And as I looked at the history of this man, it was astonishing. You're all aware of the fact that Ellen White says that there are many in the Roman Catholic Church who love Jesus and they are approved of God because they are following all the light they know and understand. Martin Luther was a Roman Catholic that was following all the light that he knew, and the Lord then revealed more light to him. But I was astonished when I looked at the history of this man. First of all, he would not allow all the pomp and pageantry and all that type of thing that usually accompanied the election of a pope. People that knew him, they gave interesting reports of when he had been a bishop. They said, "If you let him go downtown, he'll come back without any money because he goes and he finds people that are poor, that are in trouble, and he gives the money he has to them, and he always comes back, he doesn't have any money." Well, this is very interesting. And it became very evident after a few days that this man intended to completely reverse the directions that the papacy had gone under the previous pope, and it was his intention to reform the Vatican Bank and to turn the Catholic Church in a different direction. He says, we have to get the church back more like it was, was started by the founder. I thought, well, this is a very interesting analysis. Well, after a little over about 30 days, he supposedly died of a heart attack. Well, I don't believe that. There's plenty of evidence that there was foul play involved. And there's many books. I have several books. Probably some of you have books written about this subject. And by the way, just about a day or two before he died, he was having a visit by one of the highest bishops from the Soviet Union. And they were visiting, and they came in with a drink, and they each poured themselves a drink. And the bishop started to drink, and when he started to drink, he dropped over dead. So when the Pope Paul John I saw that, then he didn't drink his drink. But a day or two later, he was found dead, and it was reported that in his hand there was a book entitled On the Imitation of Christ. I thought, that's very, very interesting. Going to be very interesting when you get to the kingdom of heaven to find out who's there and who's not there. Is my life an imitation of Christ's life? Am I attempting to imitate his life, to copy his life? Now, this requires some work. This requires some work. And I want to read to you a statement from Volume 5, page 605, that talks about the work that we need to do. She's been writing here in this page about, you know, there's problems with young people, and the young people are making lots of different mistakes. And sometimes older people get very upset about mistakes that young people make. And she says this: we must expect to meet and bear with great imperfections in those who are young and inexperienced. Christ has bidden us seek to restore such in the spirit of meekness, and he holds us responsible for pursuing a course which will drive them to discouragement, despair, and ruin. Unless we daily cultivate the precious plant of love, we are in danger of becoming narrow, unsympathetic, bigoted, and critical, esteeming ourselves righteous when we are far from being approved of God. Some are uncourteous, abrupt, and harsh. They are like chestnut burrs. They prick whenever touched. These do incalculable harm by misrepresenting our loving Savior. I've had people right here in the church say to me, well, when there's trouble, there's strife among the brothers and sisters, and they say, well, I just say what I think. I just said what I thought. Concerning people with this type of a problem, one time Ellen White, this was when she was in Europe, and she was talking about character traits of the Italian people. Now, if you're Italian, please don't take offense, but I'm going to tell you what Ellen White said about these Italian people that she met. She said, it's like they cut you off at the ear. She said, these people would make very good surgeons, but very poor nurses. Do you get the idea what she's talking about? They were so direct and so abrupt with what, saying what they thought, that they hurt other people. He says, some are uncourteous, abrupt, and harsh. Let me ask you this question. I'm not trying to accuse you or anybody, but I want you to think this through. Do you believe that there's going to be any uncourteous people in heaven? If I have a problem being uncourteous, and incidentally, this is a problem that I've had to work on a great deal in my life. If I have a problem being uncourteous, this is something that I have to overcome because Jesus was never uncourteous. People say, well, he rebuked people. He did. He sometimes gave stern rebukes. Think it through. Ellen White says that there were tears in his voice when he gave these stern rebukes. People got the idea that although he was rebuking them, he loved them and wanted to save them. One of the more difficult things to deal with in the home or in the church is when there's just sharp disagreements between different people about different things. How do you deal with that? Well, the Lord allows these things so that we can learn how to deal with each other in a courteous way, in a way that's not abrupt, and in a way that's not harsh when you don't see things the same. You see, if everybody thought the same everything. My brother and I, by the way, used to talk about this years ago. And we both have the same idea. I still have the same idea. That in heaven, maybe if you don't believe this, I'm going to have an argument with you. But in heaven, I don't believe that everybody is going to think just the same about everything. So can I get along with somebody that thinks is different in some ways than myself? Ellen White says that God brings people with opposite temperaments into the same family. Well, why in the world does he do that? It can be so difficult to get along with somebody that is an opposite temperament of your own. Friend, that's part of our preparation for getting ready for heaven. It says, unless we daily cultivate the precious plant of love, we are in danger of becoming narrow, unsympathetic, bigoted, and critical, esteeming ourselves righteous when we are far from being approved of God. We are Seventh-day Adventists. Because we are Seventh-day Adventists, or Free Seventh-day Adventists, we know some things from Bible prophecy that other people around us do not know. Not everybody in this town or any town understands and believes in the soon second coming of Christ. Ellen White saw in vision that when the judgments of God would fall, that there would be some of our people who would say, we knew these things were coming, but we just didn't know it was going to come this soon. And then she said, others heard them say that, and they said to our people, they said, you knew? I didn't know. How come you never told me? I think of that. We need to think of that with in regard to people with whom we do business, people that we're acquainted with. We may not have a social relationship with them, we have a business relationship with them. Do they know what we believe? Are we asking the Lord to teach us what to do, to show them what we believe so that they can have a chance to make a decision? That's what Ellen White wrote about this. We are to let our light shine forth to others who are in darkness. No one will be approved of God if he waits in idle expectancy, dwelling upon the theory or doctrine of Christ's second coming, yet doing little to impart the light which God has graciously given him. We're nearing the time when every one of us, we're going to stand face to face with our Maker. We read the text in Romans 14:12. Every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. He said the same thing in 2 Corinthians 10:5. It's mentioned again in Philippians 2. And when that time comes, when the judgment comes, every case will stand before God in its true bearing. Every secret thing that men have done will appear with the motive that governed their life. As Seventh-day Adventist Christians, we need to think about this often. I am going to stand before the Lord. You're going to stand before the Lord. Paul says, each one of us, that's Romans 14:12, we will each give an account of ourselves to God. All our works will be judged. If our ambition is to be first, then we shall be last. Ellen White wrote this in the Review and Herald, June 28, 1887. If we are willing to suffer something for Christ's sake, if we are striving for spirituality, then the Lord will honor all such ambition to excel. But if we are seeking to satisfy an unholy, selfish ambition, God will humble the one who does this. But the Lord has spoken through his apostles. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. God knows us all by name. That is very interesting to me. There are a lot of people in this world that know me by number on their computer. I have no idea how many thousands of people and organizations and so forth know. They know a lot about me because of all that we have with these huge supercomputers today. We've got data on everybody in the country. But it's just a number on their computer. But my friend, you're not just a number to God. He knows you by name. He knows what spirit is in us. What spirit is in me? What kind of a spirit do I have? He will finally reward us as our works have been. No one need be in darkness in regard to the spirit which he possesses. Sin will close the gate of heaven against all who cherish it, for they will be without the holy city. Is heaven of any value to us? Then let us put away all sin that we may stand approved of God. Sin. As we live the Christian life, the Holy Spirit points out to us, and it becomes more and more clear to us exactly what sin is. And my friends, if there's anything in your life, doesn't matter what it is, if there's anything in your life, even the most secret character, nobody else needs to know about it, but if there's anything in your life that the Holy Spirit points out to you and you know in your conscience that the Holy Spirit is convicting you that this is wrong, friend, why don't you go to the Lord and talk to Him about it and say, Lord, I'm impressed that You want this out of my life and I want everything out of my life that You want out of my life. Any kind of thoughts, any kind of words, any kind of actions that You want out of my life, I want that out of my life too. You see, I've become convicted in the last few years. I've gotten in a lot of trouble preaching about this the last couple of years too. I've become convicted that Seventh-day Adventists actually do not know what sin is. Now, we think, we always say, we're so confident. We say, of course I know what it is. It's the transgression of the law. I have no argument with that. Friend, do you understand what thoughts, what words, what actions violate the law? Something we need to talk to the Lord about. Is there something in my life that is contrary to the spirit of the Ten Commandments? Incidentally, I've marveled over this many, many times. In our world, in our human society, we have human governments, and we have made in our world literally billions of laws. God has a law that He wrote out that a little child can understand it pretty well. Teenager can understand it perfectly. Ten principles. It sums up, as Solomon said, it sums up the whole duty of man. It covers everything. David said it's very broad. That's a part of our problem. We don't understand how broad the law of God is. Yet the law of God takes into account the thoughts and the intents of my heart and the spirit motivating me to action. That's all covered in the law of God. If we have wasted time in the past, we need to ask the Lord to help us redeem the time and not waste any more time in getting our life so that it's approved of God. Ellen White wrote about this. He said, life is short. The things of the world must perish with the using. I want to say just something about that very quickly. For any of you here that are young, I'm old enough to be acquainted with a number of different people that were in their 80s or 90s and were full of regret because they saw all the mistakes they'd made and they were. My dear friend, if you're a young person, study what we're talking about today seriously and say, Lord, help me to live in a way to be approved of You so that if you get older before the Lord comes, that your life is not full of regrets because of mistakes you made because you didn't listen to divine counsel. Life is short. The things of the world must perish with the using. Let us be wise and build for eternity. We cannot afford to idle away our precious moments or engage in busy activities that will bring forth no fruit for eternity. Let the time hitherto devoted to idleness, frivolity, and worldliness be spent in gaining a knowledge of the Scriptures, in beautifying our life and blessing and ennobling the lives and characters of others. This work will be approved of God and win for us the heavenly benediction. Well done. when Jesus comes. There are going to be many, many surprises. Here's what a Christian once said about this. He said, when he got to heaven, he expected to meet with three causes of wonder. He would wonder to find that some that he did not expect to see there. He would wonder not to see some that he expected to meet. And lastly, he would wonder most to find so unworthy a sinner as himself in the paradise of God. Many who have stood in high places as Christians upon earth will not be found with the happy throng that shall surround the throne. Those who have had knowledge and talent and yet have delighted in controversy and unholy strife will not have a place with the redeemed. Their hearts were not in harmony with the meekness and denial of Christ. They desired to do some great work that they might be admired and flattered by men. But their names were not written in the book of life. But those whose lives were made beautiful by little acts of kindness. Now listen to this carefully. Those whose lives were made beautiful by little acts of kindness, by tender words of affection and sympathy, whose hearts recoiled from strife and contention, who never did any great work in order to be lauded of men, these are found recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life. Though the world counted them as insignificant, they are approved of God before the assembled universe. They are astonished to hear the word spoken from the lips of the Divine Master, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that is prepared for you from the foundation of the world." How do I treat other people? How do I treat other people? If I know of people that are in trouble, I was just reading the other day, Ellen White said that the story of the Good Samaritan is an illustration of the life, the mission of Christ. This is from 19 Manuscript Places, page 214. No one is approved of God in being severe in bruising the souls of his fellow men. You have your Bible? There's a short chapter, a short psalm, that is completely devoted to explaining who is going to be approved of God in the judgment. Let's read it. It's so short we can read it. We can find all 11 characteristics that are mentioned. It's Psalm 15. 11 characteristics are mentioned of the person that will be approved of God. It says, Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? Who may dwell in your holy hill? He who walks uprightly, that's number one. Works righteousness, that's number two. Speaks the truth in his heart, that's number three. He who does not backbite with his tongue, number four. Nor does evil to his neighbor, that's number five. Nor does he take up a reproach against his friend, that's number six. in whose eyes a vile person is despised. That's number 7. But he honors those who fear the Lord. That's number 8. Here's a hard one. He who swears to his own hurt and does not change. Number 10. He who does not put out his money at usury. That's excessive interest. I've told you before, when we first moved to Southern California, we had purchased our first house. So we owned our own home, first time. But nobody knew us in Southern California because we just moved there from North Dakota. And I needed to get a little cash. No bank would loan me anything. I only needed about $300. So I went to a finance company and borrowed the $300, and they charged me 29% interest. I thought it was a little high. So I took care to get that loan paid off in a few months. By the way, some translations have translated this as interest. That's a mistranslation. That's not it. It's not interest, it's usury. Usury is excessive interest. It is perfectly lawful to charge interest even to other church members, other people in the Christian faith today when you're making a loan, because we're living in a time of very much inflation. And so if you loan money to somebody, but they pay it back, but they don't pay any interest, they're not actually paying you back because they're paying you back later with dollars that are worth less than the dollars they were loaned. So you think that through. I learned in the legal work we had to do this summer in Colorado that in the state of Colorado, if it's not specified, the state law is that the interest rate would be 8%. Thought that was interesting. And then the last one, number 11, says, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things will never be moved. One of these days, my friends, the people of this world are going to find out that the approval of God is worth more than all the silver, gold, or anything else that you have in this world. They're going to find out that to every action of their life, there was an invisible witness who wrote it down in his book. Am I living for myself? Or am I living to help other people, my family, and my fellow men? Years ago, I was awestruck when I found in the book Desire of Ages how the devil succeeds in tempting people. And when they decide to live for self, the devil's satisfied. Very interesting. That's in Desire of Ages. Very interesting statement. If I desire to live for self, myself, the devil is satisfied. He knows he's got me. That's his problem. He lives for self. Signs of the Times, February 24, 1890. To esteem others better than themselves is a great trial to those who are naturally self-inflated. There are many who despise those who have had advantages inferior to their own in birth or education. Are there some people that because of their birth, their heredity, or because of their education, they have less advantages than somebody else? Are there people like that? There are lots of people like that. And because of the disadvantage, their heredity, now people say, well, it's not fair. Of course it's not fair. Reddit isn't fair. When I was about 18 years old and I was taken through the Ridge Home in Denver, Colorado, and I saw these boys about that long laying in a bed in diapers that were 16 and 17 years old. They had been born with a brain that just didn't function. They could cry like a baby, and that's all they could do. And you look at that, and you say, this is awful. Well, it is awful. And it's not fair. They did nothing to deserve that. But they got an extremely defective heredity, so they can't even function as a human being. So there are people that because of their birth, their heredity, or because of their lack of education, they may be apparently greatly inferior to you or me. And it's very easy to look down on people like that. She said it is. It's very easy to look down on people like that. He said, they exalt their own judgment and experience and look disparagingly upon those who have had to battle with greater obstacles. There are some people, friends, that are battling with greater obstacles than others to overcome. And we need to pray for and help these people and not criticize them when we see them making mistakes. Could they see as God sees, they would have a different estimation, both of themselves and of those whom they think inferior. Every step of progress that is made by those who have to battle for advancement wins the approval of God. And we should take heed that we despise not one of these little ones, for their angels do always behold the face of their Father. My dear friend, whatever the disadvantages that you're dealing with, whatever the terrible obstacles that you're dealing with to overcome, you will meet the approval of God and say, Lord, take me and make me yours and help me to take an advanced step. God doesn't ask you to jump to the top of a ladder at one time, but if you're taking advanced steps and you're seeking to do His will and to overcome, you will meet His approval, even if you haven't reached perfection yet. The God we serve is so wonderfully reasonable. He accepts people in their imperfection when they choose to turn to Him, and He gives them His Holy Spirit to help them make progress, to help them be changed. Now, there are some things, of course, that will never be changed until Jesus comes again. I was very interested. I didn't know that Ellen White had written so plainly on this until in the last couple of years, I read through the manuscript releases. I'd have to look which one it is that I read this. But Ellen White was visiting a home. And there was a child in this home that had been born with an extremely defective inheritance so that the child was totally incapacitated, couldn't talk, like a baby. And Ellen White looked at this child. And she said, when Jesus comes, the defect in this child is going to be taken away. This child is going to be made a normal person. I thought, this is fascinating. We have wonderful things in store when Jesus comes if we choose to follow Him. If you are the most inferior, the most defective human beings, if you're at the bottom of the pit of sin and there's no way out, the Lord can save you if you turn to Him and choose to follow Him and commit everything to Him. I've said this many times. I want to repeat it again before we close. There will be nobody in the day of judgment that will be able to say, Lord, I chose to commit everything to You and to follow You with all my heart, and now I'm lost. There will not be one person that will be able to say that. If there was one person that would be able to say that, truthfully, it would destroy the government of God because He says that's not going to happen. The Bible says that Jesus is able to save perfectly everyone that comes to Him. But we need to come and we need to choose to make progress and not wait and be careless and allow sin to go undetected and overcome in our lives. Let's pray before we go. Father in heaven, We want to live in a way that our thoughts, our words, and our actions will meet with your approval. And we pray that you'll help each one of us in the struggles we go through in the Christian life, that we might be overcomers and that our thoughts and words and actions might come into perfect harmony with your law, with the life of Jesus. We pray this in his name and for his sake. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.